I'm Richard Portis, Professor of Economics at London Business School and Vice Chair of the Advisory Scientific Committee, and therefore partly responsible for the organization of this event, but also co-chair of the Joint Expert Group on Shadow Banking. This is an amazing panel. The biggest brains on the planet, except for maybe mine. There's no need to listen to them before you vote them through, yeah, right? There's not one old white male among them. They're gonna put on a truly great performance. They're gonna make Europe great again. Yeah, we were talking about the problems of Europe. This is all very exciting, but first you have to listen to me for a few minutes. Yeah? Sorry about that. First on shadow banking and non-banks and all that. Some of you will know that the FSB decided, in its wisdom, that they would replace the term shadow banking by non-bank financial intermediation, and that will come into all their publications, as well as the discourse. This institution has yet to make a decision on that. I think it's very unwise. The reason, supposedly, is that shadow banking carries a pejorative, negative connotation. And non-bank financial intermediation, that's a good thing, of course. And since we have now supposedly progressed to a resilient system of market-based finance, we should put this shadow banking term back in its box. I think that's wrong. I think we have not progressed to a resilient market-based finance system. There are weaknesses in the system, in the institutions and the activities that we comprehend in shadow banking. And on that, I suggest that you have a look at our shadow banking monitor, which just came out a couple of weeks ago, which was mentioned yesterday, and which I think is an excellent publication, if I do say so, which indicates what the weaknesses and the risks and so forth are. And if you just look, and we had a discussion in the general board of ESRB yesterday about the risk. We always do every session. You can see that there are risks, that the risks in asset management, for various reasons, may be going up, that leveraging in hedge funds appears to be going up, that maturity transformation in asset management appears to be going up, that lending to hedge funds is still pro-cyclical. This does not leave me entirely happy or calm, shall we say. So I think that to eliminate the term shadow banking because we've got it sorted, in a sense, is unwise. The second remark that I would make is on whether shadow banks are systemically important. You can tell a story about insurance companies, for example, saying they're not systemically important, really. If one goes down, well, so what? Well, of course, there is an example from the crisis. You remember AIG, yes? That's an insurance company that clearly had to be bailed out, right? And so it depends on what the insurance company is doing and what its interconnections are with the rest of the financial system. And that's the key thing. It's the interconnections, and in particular between banks and shadow banks. I've done, together with some colleagues here and in other central banks, some work on the interconnection between banks and shadow banks using EBA data. We'll be able to do more when we get the AIFMD data on stream, right? I think there are reasons for concern there. Mario Draghi yesterday talked about the need for macro-approved policies for non-banks. I think he did say non-banks, I'm afraid. But in another sentence, he did talk about the shadow banking monitor, so that's okay. Why do we need macro-approved policies for non-banks or shadow banks? Because there are issues there, right? And they are issues that are not going to go away for a while. And finally, I would try to be a little bit provocative about the naming question. I don't think it's a trivial question. I'll be a little bit provocative about CCPs, knowing that Kathleen is going to talk in much more detail about them. But it's a very, CCPs are a very interesting financial market utility, they've been called. It's part of the infrastructure, and it is a utility. Saying that it's a utility suggests to you, should these really be private sector organizations? Should they be profit-making organizations? And if you think about it a little more, you say, wait a minute here. It's clearly, there are obvious network economies, if you like, and economies of scale here. Indeed, this is a natural monopoly in principle, right? It should be, it is. And therefore, it seems to me that given the interconnections between the existing CCPs, which you will see from Kathleen's talk, given that there are weaknesses of individual CCPs, and we saw an example of that only a few weeks ago in Sweden, when a CCP got into trouble and came very close to failing, right? The so-called waterfall of bringing in capital was almost ran dry. What would have been done then? Well, that's a very interesting question because there's no resolution procedure in place. And so there are dangers here, A. B, there is a rationale, I think an economic rationale, for putting them all under one roof, and that is to say, for consolidating them and having a single CCP. But that I leave for discussion. So I think I'll stop there and let this amazing panel get to work.